De Cannabis Cup. Deze week weer in Amsterdam. Een paar duizend Amerikanen die cannabis komen vieren. Want daar komt het eigenlijk op neer. Die marihuana, hemp, cannabis in alle variëteiten, in allerlei producten komen zien, proeven, gebruiken, erover praten. En gezamenlijk ook heel veel feest vieren. Bijvoorbeeld gisteravond met Patti Smith in de Melkweg. En het is eigenlijk een beetje een schande voor de organisatie dat dat niet uitverkocht was. Cultureel Amsterdam heeft een krant voorbij laten gaan. De kranten hebben er niet over geschreven. Niemand had eigenlijk in de gaten dat de toch wel heel befaamde Patti Smith met een fantastische optreden in de Melkweg stond gisteravond. Dus er waren om 11 uur zelfs nog kaartjes te krijgen. Schandalig voor de pers die het niet heeft zien aankomen. Wij hebben een reportage ervan gemaakt, maar vanwege de Bima Stemra kunnen we er maar hele kleine stukjes van laten zien. Maar we zijn natuurlijk wel op de Cannabis Cup geweest in het Pax Party House. Een hele show van producten, rookproducten, paraphernalia, maar ook hennepproducten. Heel veel mode, heel veel producten van hennep. Die combinatie van cannabis en hennep, hemp in het Amerikaans, is heel duidelijk. Het is natuurlijk dezelfde plant, alleen wanneer die industrieel wordt gekweekt, zit er minder THC in, wordt er minder stone van, maar kun je er wel kleren van maken. En het draait allemaal om de Cannabis Cup, een beetje commerciële opzet, want de coffeeshops die goed adverteren in High Times, die krijgen natuurlijk makkelijker een prijs. Veel jaren zie je dan ook veel herhalingen van dezelfde clubs die steeds dezelfde prijs hebben. Heel veel coffeeshops zeggen we doen niet meer mee, want al die Amerikanen, wat hebben we eraan? Die willen alleen maar gratis roken. Maar het idee is dat er dus gekozen wordt wat de beste cannabis is. En er zijn, u ziet het, hele vreemde contrapties om ook marihuana of hashish of wiet of wat dan ook maar te roken. En zo'n beurs is eigenlijk wel interessant. Voornamelijk toch Amerikanen, Duitsers, buitenlanders die hier komen. Want in Amsterdam zelf wordt er niet veel ruchtbaarheid aangegeven. De Cannabis Cup is een beetje voor outsiders. En er staan zelfs wat cannabisplanten hier in vreemd licht, moeten we wel zeggen. Want dat zijn dan van die groeilampen. En daar krijg je dus een heel vreemd gevoel voor over wat cannabis dan doet. Het zijn echt groene plantjes, maar in het licht wat we hier hebben, zien ze er wat anders uit. En dan weer die vreemde pijp. Hier zit de cannabis in. Het is echt een monsterding waar je met de hele familie, zou ik maar zeggen, aan kunt lurken. Cannabis Cup. Hier hebben we het licht even wat anders gezet, zodat u kunt zien dat het echt gewoon groene planten zijn. En het kweken van die dingen is voorbehouden aan Nederlanders, 5 plantjes. Maar de hele wereld kweekt natuurlijk in zijn achtertuin cannabis. De zaden worden over de hele wereld verspreid en dat is een deel van de handel. Nederland is behoorlijk vooraanstaand in het kweken van de juiste soorten cannabis met een hoog THC-gehalte. Dus een hoog gehalte aan de actieve stof. En we zijn echt een centrum voor deze handel. En dat kan de burgemeester misschien niet zo leuk vinden, omdat het Amsterdam een slecht image geeft. Maar heel veel toeristen komen toch naar Amsterdam om hier een jointje te roken. The joint capital of the world. Wat elders niet mag, kan hier wel. En eigenlijk is dat best wel aardig. Want zo gevaarlijk is cannabis niet. Dat weten we ondertussen. Het heeft zelfs heel goede medische effecten voor mensen die bijvoorbeeld lijden aan multiple sclerose of na bestralingen last hebben van misselijkheid. Kortom, daar komen we wel op terug. We gaan een aantal interviews doen, waaronder één met Steven Gaskin. Hij was de tegenkandidaat van Ralph Nader voor de Groene Partij voor de kandidatuur voor het presidentschap. Hij heeft dat uiteindelijk opgegeven, maar hij was een heel bekende schrijver, spiritueel schrijver, die toch in Amerika grote bekendheid geniet en die in Amsterdam was. We gaan eens praten met Steven Gaskin.
Cannabis Cup in Amsterdam. Ieder jaar een tijd dat allerlei mensen uit Amerika komen die heel veel te maken hebben met drugs, met de war on drugs. En we praten met Steven Gaskin. Steven is actief in de Amerikaanse politiek geweest. Hij was eerst kandidaat voor de Groene Partij. Hij heeft zich teruggetrokken als presidentskandidaat. Maar het is wel een man die weet wat er speelt, met name op het gebied van de war on drugs in Amerika. Welkom, Steven.
Hi, nice to be here.
Yeah. Nice to have you in Amsterdam.
It's really good. It's always a sane place to be, coming from the craziness at home.
I thought Amsterdam was a crazy place.
Oh, no. We're much crazier these days.
The election, which is on everybody's mind in the States, I presume.
Yeah, although it's getting to be like Castaway or one of those shows. You're getting used to the show, you know, so it's beginning not drawing the ratings it used to draw.
A phrase that everybody knows now is too close to call.
Well, that's the deal, but that's kind of funny because they say, look, the United States is divided right down the middle. No, there's a remainder. It's called the Greens and the Reforms and the Independents and all those folks, and they're not telling you about the remainder. They act like it's a big deal because George is 300 votes ahead of Al in Florida. Well, Ralph Nader got 89,000 votes in Florida, too. You know, and they asked Nader if he thought he was a spoiler. He said, no, Al spoiled it for himself. He's known what I was talking about for years. He could have borrowed two or three of my planks and made himself up enough to beat this.
Now, the story is that you were also a candidate. Last year when we spoke to you, you were trying to be a presidential or vice presidential candidate for the Green Party.
Right. I was running against Ralph for the nomination of the Green Party. And I got to go to the convention, which was very good, in Colorado and Denver. And I actually carried the state of Georgia at the convention, so I even carried a state. But the good thing was...
Tell me a little bit. I mean, people don't understand. You are Stephen Gaskin. You have written books about cannabis and other things. You're living at a place that's called a farm. Tell a little bit about yourself, why you were running for this candidacy.
Well, the main reason is because I turned 65 years old this year, and the country has gotten less free all my life. And I remember when the Constitution meant more than it does now. And I've observed the enormous buyout. When I was little, we were coming out of Roosevelt having taken on the big trusts, you know, and leveled out the playing field for a little while. But the war contracts from World War II bent it back again, and then the big fortunes that were made there continue.
Wait a moment. You said that the war and some that we talk about, the military-industrial complex, took hold of liberty again.
Yeah, well, we've been almost continually on a war footing since the 40s, and it's either been, you know...
When I travel in the States, I don't see no war. What are you meaning?
Well, I mean that we have troops all over the world, and that
Korea, Vietnam, the Gulf.
And there's still bases in Germany and, you know, all around, you know, and they're making so much money, they don't know how to back that down, you know. But the problem is the money that's being made there is being made by big corporations, and not much of that gets into the pockets of ordinary people. So the country is really split, and we got the folks who are part of the complex who are doing pretty well, and the rest of the folks who are not. And the country's split in more ways than that. Because of the drug wars, it's as if 20% of the country is under martial law. And the rest of the country thinks they're under the Constitution, but the martial law part means they can kick down your door, or they can take all your stuff, and they can confiscate your property before the trial, before they decide if you're guilty or not. They can
war on drugs, but bring this back into the context of the election. We have Bush and Gore. Now, Bush is, and this is a rumor and not substantiated, seemingly being involved in some cocaine trade or dealing, and Gore is known to have smoked a few joints here or there. You would expect those people to be a little bit more lenient towards the use of cannabis, for instance.
They're both hypocrites about it, but the deal is each one's afraid to bring it up, and so they've made this deal that they won't bring it up, because if one of them says pot, the other one says coke, you know, and there goes the argument, you know. But Ralph, the Greens in the United States had not come out about marijuana, and partly it was because Ralph thought of it as like a consumer product that might be harmful rather than looking at the civil rights of the issue.
Now, Ralph Nader, Europeans don't know, but he was the patriot of consumer rights about cars and all kinds of products.
Yeah, and if you ever got bumped off an airline and had to get paid for being bumped in the airline, that was him too. And your Freedom of Information Act was some more Ralph. He's done huge things like that. And so I was running. I figured he would probably get the nomination, but the Greens invited me in. They wanted me to come and be part of it.
We can see this little thing here. Stephen Gaskin for president, 2000, Green Party of Tennessee. So, in fact, you are a politician, but at the same time, you are a cannabis believer.
Well, yeah. I feel like that if the people who follow cannabis were all the same kind of an ethnic group, and they all had the same vowel at the end of their last name, or all had the same kind of hair or something, you know, it would be a massive civil rights question to have millions of them locked up.
The same like with the peyote.
Yeah.
But it isn't. Everybody is using that from...
Well, the Indians are a lot more careful about how they use peyote than they used to be because they have to fall within the government guidelines, you know. But I think that warriors would use it when they would go hunting. They would might chew a couple of buttons just to, you know, for the speed of it all, to get out there and you know, and be one with the countryside.
Yes. So. You're obviously one who has been high in the clouds. On the other hand, the books you write is about the spiritual nature of using cannabis and using drugs.
Well, the thing about cannabis and the psychoactive drugs is that they give people a look into their own psyche. And if you started off from a virginal place going to study a religion, you could read books and meditate for years and years and years before you would ever have a taste, you know. And the thing about marijuana can show you in about half an hour that there is another state of mind than the one that you usually live in. And that is part of you, and it doesn't go away, and it's not an illusion, and it's something that was dormant in you that woke up with the stimulus. And then, as happened in the 60s, people who had that taste like that, many of them became interested in meditation and stuff to see if they could get to the same place.
What you're saying is that drugs and psychedelic drugs and cannabis gives you a sneak preview, a better version of paradise, of another world. There now,
it ain't paradise, and you know this is paradise. You know this is paradise. This is the place. This is where the action's all happening, and it's whatever we make it. And so it's really nice right here in Amsterdam right now, but just some of the rest of the world is pretty rough and rocky. And it's the old question of the bodhisattva again, which is once you get to your position on the edge of the wheel and can look down and see the wheel of life, you realize there's a lot of people in trouble, and you can't really leave at this point. You got to go back and help out.
Is that one of your motivations too?
Yeah, I think that Buddhism is like a riddle, and you're not supposed to fall for the Buddha. You're supposed to realize the Bodhisattva who goes back is where it's at.
So you're really saying what, according to the Gospel of Thomas, Jesus Christ has said, heaven is now. We just have to see it.
Yeah.
But why then use cannabis or drugs to get that sneak preview of heaven now?
I don't know how, I can't say how it was back in the days when we were hunters and gatherers, but right now civilization...
Mushrooms, though, in those days.
There were, but we have such a heavy matrix of civilization laid down on us. You know, language, driving on the proper side of the street, all that business is really laid down heavily on us. And if we...
You say matrix. Do you mean it like a hypnotic imprint?
Well, it's an imprint of all of society. And it's about that for the most part we say yeah like that and no like that, you know, we have agreements that go across languages and around the world and stuff that have been in effect for thousands of years, and if you want to like see anything new, you have to have a look at who you started, where was your, well I guess they say what was your original face, you know, so you want to look at your original face, and then after you see your
but Indians. Went looking for the original face on something they called a vision quest, which was not taking cannabis, but going out in nature and living with the animals and finding their true self, their true face, their true name.
Usually for a vision quest, going without food and stuff like that until they go into a visionary state too. Vision quest was specifically to have a vision. And
so there's not much difference between not eating for a few days out in nature and taking a joint.
Yeah, I suppose I would think that it might be a little cleaner to go out and not eat for a few days, but I don't really have time to do that all the time. And the other thing is that people enjoy playing with their bodies in many ways, and some of them are even dangerous. So they go snowboarding down alpine peaks, and you know, and they go deep sea diving and all that kind of stuff, and parachuting and bungee jumping and stuff like that, and everybody. Watches it on television and it's fine, but you want to play with your mind, and you want to smoke a little pot to say, oh, that pot's dangerous, it might give you bronchitis. Well, could we apply those same standards to dirt bikes, for instance,
or cars or airplanes?
Yeah, all that stuff, you know,
atomic power plants,
Concords, you know, the works. And so they're suddenly very worried about it, and it's like the kind of hypocrisy that we have among the hard religious right in the United States, where every sperm is sacred, but when they're 18, you can kill them.
if I have a question, say, is changing the inner part of human beings more important than changing the world we live? We have this climate conference at the moment in The Hague. People are worried about the temperature of the earth, you know. Is it more important to start on the inside or on the outside?
I think that we've been running around on the inside for a few decades now. We ought to know where it is by now. And that as the American Green Party with Ralph Nader has said that they're still about the environment and about the trees and stuff. But if you don't do something about the corporations, you can't do anything about any of the rest of the issues if you don't do something about the corporations first. And that's the same thing as if we don't change
the system. You said corporation. Are you talking about the structure of morality in our society?
I'm talking about like the Supreme Court decision, the United States Supreme Court of 1868, which granted the same rights and privileges of complete personhood to corporations, just as the same as a natural person, which was a legal fiction, they call that.
And but it has become reality.
It has become reality, and that means that they can that they can say that the corporation stands as the one to risk anything. And the people who work in the corporation are just employees, even the CEO. So the corporations can't really be sued or you can't really do anything to them anymore. And the only thing they do fear is lawyers, which is that's what tort reform is code for. The corporations are afraid of lawyers because the lawyer might take them out. You know, a lawyer can give capital punishment to a corporation.
Which brings us back where we started, the elections. It's now courts and lawyers and Supreme Courts, and you know, it's like we get a view of the American system. Millions are spent on petty cases, like are the holes when they're not totally in the stuff like that. How do you feel about that?
Well, in the first place, that we have the state of the art that we have in guns and airplanes and bombs and stuff like that, and we're still poking holes in pieces of paper for an election is just really ridiculous. You know?
In the machines that were made by IBM, you know, like 50
years ago. Ancient things, you know. And they could have them in, they could have each person come in and have a nice bright screen for the old folks to see, you know, with nice big colorful type and like that. And it would be easy to see, and then they could run it out on burn onto a CD, you know, and have a solid copy of it that couldn't be tampered with. And
punch card technology, indeed, when I started studying this 30 years ago, that was what we used to do our algorithms, and that was called a computer then. And
right. I used to talk about that if all the religions were all lined up like IBM cards, that some holes would go clear through. You know, those were the parts I was interested in.
That is the spiritual core of all religions.
Yeah, I think so. You see the ones that go clear through, and some are cultural. They only go through a couple of cards.
Well, I hope you have a good week here in Amsterdam, as you usually have.
My daughter is here to be part of Iname's entourage as a goddess and all that. And she has a couple of midwife friends coming over. Your wife should be sure to get in touch with her because there's going to be...
We will sure have some interviews with Iname. And I hope you have a good time here. Nice to have you here. A little bit of the green from America. And who's your favorite now that Bush and Gore are...
Oh, I can't tell the difference between them. You know, I've known Al 25 years. He's metamorphosed into something that I can't recognize anymore.
Okay.
I don't know who it is anymore.
Okay. Thank you, Stephen Gaskin.
De Cannabis Cup. Ontzettend veel producten, maar ook ontzettend veel politiek. Dit gesprek met de tegenstrever van Ralph Nader binnen de Groene Partij. Hij was dus eigenlijk tegenkandidaat van Ralph Nader. Maar wel bezig om ook presidentskandidaat voor de Groene te worden. Stephen Gaskin sprak over de politiek en de spiritualiteit op deze Cannabis Cup Fair in Parks Party House. Zijn het vooral producten. Allerlei dingen. Van hennep. Mensen die hun producten promoten. Eagle Bill is dit. Een bekende figuur uit de wereld van de cannabis. Iemand die apparatuur ontwikkelt om te roken zonder dat je zeg maar de slechte dingen naar binnen krijgt. Er zijn dichters. Er zijn de mensen uit seed companies. Je ziet Ben Dronkers met een dichter. Er zijn allerlei figuren uit de cannabis scene. Dit is die dichter die een gedicht heeft geschreven over cannabis, een Amerikaanse dichter. We gaan dadelijk nog een gesprek met hem voeren. Maar ook producten om bijvoorbeeld je bolletjes marihuana te malen. Allerlei soorten pijpjes. Er is enorm veel te zien op zo'n beurs. En ja, hier kun je dat zien. Een bolletje marihuana. En dan malen. Daar komt het op neer. Producten, petten. Je kan het zo gek niet bedenken. En alles met dat bekende teken, de 7 blaadjes van de cannabis sativa. Hier wordt dat even voorgedaan. Hoe je met zo'n maaldingetje, een houten doosje, je bolletje kunt gereed maken om het bijvoorbeeld in een joint te stoppen. Allemaal producten die door mensen uit de hele wereld ontwikkeld worden en hier op deze cannabis cup eigenlijk aan de man worden gebracht. En dat wordt dan weer in coffeeshops over de hele wereld of onder de toonbank. Headshops heten ze in Amerika, waar je de paraphernalia kunt vinden, waar je de pijpjes, dat soort dingen allemaal kunt vinden, wordt dat verkocht. En soms heel interessant, zoals hier pijpjes met een gouden binnenkant, allemaal, het moet zo zuiver mogelijk zijn en liefst met zo min mogelijk slechte stoffen. Maar we gaan eens even kijken wat de organisatie ervan vindt. Ingrid doet een interview met Peter Balk.
Hallo, ik ben Ingrid van Gestel en ik spreek hier met Peter Balk. Hij is degene voor Nederland die de cup organiseert, die hier een hele week plaatsvindt. We zijn nu op de Ferdinand Bol in het Pax Partyhouse. En ja, ik wil Peter wat vragen stellen over de conventie. Kan jij ons wat meer vertellen? Waarom wordt die georganiseerd? Want dit is al de 13e keer dat die plaatsvindt.
13e keer, ja. Waarom we het steeds blijven doen? Ja, er is veel vraag aan naar vanuit Amerika, maar eigenlijk vanuit de hele wereld. En ik doe ook heel veel andere beurzen met hennepkleding en ik kom op heel veel andere congressen. En ik merk gewoon, ja, de cup, de Cannabis Cup staat gewoon voor iets. Dat kan alleen maar hier gebeuren in Amsterdam, waar de coffeeshops zijn, waar we de Grote Melkweg een week kunnen afhuren en het Pax Partyhuis en zoiets als dit kunnen organiseren.
De Melkweg afhuren, maar vertel eens, wat gaat er dan allemaal gebeuren? Want het is een heel programma. Wat is precies de bedoeling en wat houdt het allemaal in? Er zijn 3000 Amerikanen hier op het moment.
Ja, er zijn 3000 Amerikanen en nog meer buitenlanders uit Engeland, uit heel Europa, Japan, die hier naartoe komen om, of omdat ze met hennep of marihuana bezig zijn en dat het dus hun werk is en dat ze daarom hier naartoe komen voor hun profession. Anderen komen hier naartoe omdat ze gewoon een groot liefhebber zijn van het roken. En weer andere mensen zijn heel erg politiek bezig met of in Amerika of in hun eigen land om het te legaliseren of het te normaliseren. En dus ja, in het Pax Partyhuis hebben we overdag van 11 uur 's ochtends tot 6 uur 's avonds een expo met hennepbedrijven, seed companies, zaadbedrijven, heel veel andere kleine bedrijfjes, maar ook organisaties die hier besprekingen houden en dingen vertellen waar ze mee bezig zijn. Groeiers die vertellen hoe je wiet moet groeien en dat soort dingen, dat is wat het Pax betreft. En 's avonds gaan we allemaal naar de Melkweg en daar hebben we wat grote bands uitgehuurd die die in de Max spelen. En in de oude zaal hebben we 3 dagen lang een coffeeshop lounge waar de 19 coffeeshops die dit jaar meedoen een tafel krijgen en daar met de judges kunnen praten.
Maar goed, wat houdt het dan precies in? Want er zijn dus 19 coffeeshops die meedoen. Je hebt net verteld wat er allemaal te doen is. Maar de uiteindelijke cup zelf, dat is een prijs, die gaat uitgereikt worden. Waar gaat het om? Waar moeten coffeeshops aan voldoen om die prijs te winnen?
Nou, coffeeshops, waar ze precies aan moeten doen, dat is niet helemaal zwart op wit. We hebben er nu 19. Als ik nu een 20e zou krijgen, zou ik zeggen van, nou, je moet wel anders zijn als die anderen. Want ik heb er al 19. Dus als jij hetzelfde bent als die, ja, dan vul je niks aan mijn bestand. Dus als jij in Osdorp zit, is logistiek voor mij niet haalbaar.
Nee, maar ik bedoel eigenlijk degene, de jury, dus het publiek zelf, die gaat stemmen. Wie is de leukste coffeeshop? Wat moet een coffeeshop doen? Moet de hash of de marihuana het lekkerste smaken? Moet je er het blijst van worden? Of wat zijn de criteria?
Nou, als je zeg maar 2000 van de mensen, dat zijn de gewone judges. Die gaan de stad in, die gaan langs alle coffeeshops, die roken de producten. Zij stemmen met name op de wiet. Maar zij kunnen ook op dingen stemmen die bijvoorbeeld op de expo te zien zijn. Ze kunnen stemmen dus voor de beste coffeeshop, omdat ze die gewoon leuk vinden. Ze kunnen stemmen voor de beste wiet van een coffeeshop. Zo hebben we dus ja, dat gedeelte voor die coffeeshops op zo'n manier gedaan. Daar stemmen ze dus niet blind, want ja, ze weten van wie het is, ze kunnen het zien. We hebben nog een ander systeem, dat hebben we al afgerond. We hebben 6 mensen à la Big Brother opgesloten vorige week. Met ook alle wiet samples van alle coffeeshops. En die hebben alles blind gestemd. Dus de coffeeshops krijgen voor hun wiet, kunnen ze 2 prijzen winnen. 1 is blind opgestemd en de ander is door de, zeg maar, de gemeenschap, iedereen gewoon open opgestemd.
Hey, en de prijs die gewonnen kan worden, wat houdt het precies in? Wat is het voor prijs en wanneer gaat die uitgezonden worden? Uitgereikt worden bedoel
ik? Ik heb hem nu niet hier, maar de prijs is ongeveer zo groot. En dat is een cup, een soort een beker van zilver of van goud. En die is handgemaakt door een kunstenaar uit Amerika die ook op de Cannabis Cup speelt. Want hij is ook bluesmuzikant. Dat is de Five Points Band. En er zijn volgens mij iets van 10 cups te winnen voor de verschillende categorieën. Dus
en wanneer worden die uitgereikt?
Donderdagavond in de Melkweg uitgereikt.
En over thema dit jaar, want het gaat eigenlijk, het is de Goddess Cup dit jaar, niet de God Cup. En bovendien is het thema dit jaar de vrouwen, de bijdrage van de vrouwen aan de cannabiscultuur. Wat wil je me daar nog over vertellen? Want ik ben daar wel geïntegreerd naar dat Goddess Cup.
De Goddess Cup. Nou, we hebben al de laatste 3 jaar proberen weer een thema nog extra aan de cup te geven. We hebben de Blues Cup gehad en vorig jaar over de Jim Borrow en een paar schrijvers uit de 50e jaren, Jack Kerouac, die werden dan geonnerd. En nu dus de Goddess Cup. Dus er wordt Ina May Gaskin, de vrouw van Steve Gaskin, die wordt geonnerd. En ze hebben nog een aantal vrouwelijke celebrity judges die zeg maar weer de wiet van de zaadbedrijven gaan testen. En dat wordt ook blind gedaan. Voor de rest heet het ook de Goddess Cup, omdat de wiet die we roken eigenlijk allemaal van een vrouwelijke plant afkomstig is. Voor de rest, ja, er komen ontzettend veel mannen altijd naar die cup. Wij wilden wat meer vrouwen hier naartoe krijgen en ze daarom ook, zeg maar, eren.
Want ik hoorde dat vanavond Patti Smith optreedt in de Melkweg. Wat heb je nog meer voor vrouwelijke sterren?
We hadden een Nederlandse dame gisteren, die had een gelegenheidsband samengesteld, Bathsheba. En die komt de komende 2-3 avonden een jam organiseren in de Melkweg. En daar probeert zij natuurlijk veel liefst vrouwelijke muzikanten voor te vinden. Voor de rest hebben we nog wat kleinere performances ertussendoor. En nou, een fashion show met hennepkleding van Amsterdamse winkels en van vendors uit het Pax Partyhuis. Ja, dat is het.
Hey, jullie hadden toch ook wat hele grote namen van niet-vrouwelijke bands die optreden?
We hebben iets Jefferson Aeroplane, Starship. Ja, dat schijnt voor mijn bestaan waren die
wereldberoemd, man.
Wereldberoemd toen ik nog niet geboren was. Die schijnen nu weer hier naartoe te komen. En ja, ik heb al telefoontjes van over heel de wereld gehad. Want het schijnt dat ze maar eens in de 30 jaar spelen, die gasten. Dus het schijnt heel uniek te zijn. Maar,
Hey, dankjewel voor dit interview. Komt allemaal. Het is een fantastisch festijn. De sfeer is heel erg goed. Heel gezellig. 3000 Amerikanen die hier de dagen van hun leven beleven. Want het is natuurlijk ongelooflijk dat je dat kunt doen in dit fantastische land. Zomaar overal roken op straat. En ja, er zijn hele leuke optredens. En het is een mooi thema.
Right, you know.
Ja, gezellig, rommelig, chaotisch, dat is Cannabis Cup. De organisatie en de Amerikanen denken dat het werkelijk een enorm evenement is voor Amsterdam. Maar buiten het Pax Party House in de Melkweg merk je er dus niet veel van. Al was het maar dat bijvoorbeeld dat optreden van Patti Smith eigenlijk niet uitverkocht raakte. En dat er gisteravond nog kaartjes te krijgen waren. Het is een beetje een besloten Amerikaans evenement. Er komen wel wat buitenlanders. En er komen wat mensen uit de Amsterdamse hemp en cannabis zien, maar daarbuiten eigenlijk nauwelijks. En misschien is dat ook wel goed. Een paar duizend Amerikanen die gewoon een weekje in Amsterdam stoon komen wezen en praten. Alles onder de banier van High Times. Dat is het blad wat het organiseert en dat dus ook de Cannabis Cup weggeeft. Dit jaar dus voor de 13e keer. En we gaan eens praten met iemand die boeken uitgeeft. Iemand die foto's maakt. Een auteur, een fotograaf die al 30 jaar bezig is met het fotograferen van cannabis over de hele wereld.
Ja, daar zitten we dan op de Cannabis Cup 2000. En we praten met iemand die foto's maakt van hashish, van cannabis over de hele wereld. En daar ook fantastische boeken over gemaakt heeft. En we laten wel wat plaatjes zien. En zijn naam is Lawrence Cherniak. Hello, Lawrence. Here we are on the show.
Hi, Luke. It's a pleasure to spend a little bit of time with you, and thank you for inviting me to share some of these wonderful impressions that a lot of our friends have shared with me in the past that we'll now get to share with some of your viewing audience. Yeah. I really appreciate the opportunity to...
Okay. Well, listen, you are foremost a photographer. Yes? The photographer of hashish and marijuana.
Well, some people say that. It goes a little further than just hashish and marijuana. It's really researching the pleasures of the high society, which is what the subtitles of these books are. Most people don't notice that, but most books do have a subtitle, and the subtitle for these books is Researching the Pleasures of the High
Society. I think you should put your honey into the... Yeah, dus iemand die boeken schrijft en vooral foto's maakt over cannabis en hashish over de hele wereld. En dat is natuurlijk wel aardig, want bijvoorbeeld in India, daar heet het ganja. En in bijvoorbeeld Jamaica en allerlei landen in de wereld wordt er natuurlijk gerookt, gegeten. We were just talking about taking marijuana the other way. How do you call that? Suppositories?
Suppositories. We were talking about... present company included, you know, sticking it up your ass. And... they were going to be in the shape of lifesavers, right? You know, the candies. Yep. And they'd be little leaves wrapped around each other in the same shape as...
Now, I understood from practical experience that it's a very effective way to get the drug into your system.
Well, never having done that, I really wouldn't be able to say. But, I mean, considering you should expect me to have certainly stuck some of those things up my ass, I'm not surprised that our conversation is going in that way.
Well, actually,
because I'm supposed to be such an expert. So I appreciate your respect and thank you. But, no, I haven't gotten around to that. I've stuck them on my nipples, though.
That works.
No, I had a woman who wanted to lick them off that way, so...
No, what I was just talking with Eagle Bill about the increase in medical use of marijuana for people with multiple sclerosis and all that stuff. And for them, smoking it might not be the most appropriate way. So it's good that there are other ways.
Well, there are lots of other ways. I mean, this plant can be used in more ways than any other plant on the planet for all kinds of things. Most of us know that. However, I would suggest that... if someone is having difficulty, then they ought to, you know, use it in food. It's really a wonderful way. For example, these books have certainly got some wonderful eating and drinking ways all over the world. I've made champagne, I've made wine, all kinds of things, everything you can imagine.
Is that something that is just happening for the last five years, or is that something that has been a tradition through the ages?
No, it's been going on for thousands of years, but not like it has in the last, like you say, almost 5 years. I mean, there's so many products now. And that's what we need. We need a diversification of all these products so that the entire community is so overwhelming to this other part of our society, the establishment, as it were, and they just become ultimately totally demoralized in terms of continually trying to suppress people being able to be entrepreneurs with the great research that they've done, especially in places like Holland, which is, of course, the leading place in the world for anything to do with research about some of the things about this plant.
Sure. I mean, are you not making a compliment for the sake of the compliment?
Absolutely not. I mean, I've spent a lot of time in the last 35 years in Holland, and I've seen it. It's as clear to me as it is to you, and that's very nice of you. I mean, I think you're only doing that to motivate me and challenge me to say even more nice things about
Holland. Maybe Switzerland. I've heard that in Switzerland lots of people are also growing.
It hasn't been going on there for 25 years the way it has here. I mean, here people are totally devoid of paranoia. If they're inclined, if they're not too ambivalent and apathetic, then people here are making records and have kept research for years now that there's records. I mean, people are very paranoid to keep records in the United States. They can't do that. They can't have the evolution.
And when you say records about growing, about...
Their genetics, whatever they've done in terms of developing things over a series of years. Just a tremendous amount of research here. And the Dutch can be very proud, and the rest of the world can be very thankful. The same thing with this cannabis cup. I mean, some people don't feel it's really totally accepted yet. I believe it's very accepted here. It's not just tolerated. It's an amazing and tremendous experience. I've seen
according to the local government.
And say, this is the best day of my life when they come here.
Let me tell you something. Those are mostly American people that come here.
Well, no, there are a lot of English people who come here. There's Canadians who come here, Australians. People come here from all over the world. And that's why they're doing this, is because this is a place where suddenly there are no international barriers, Luke. And I can just see by your demeanor, the way you respond to me. That's what we're dealing with.
But here we see the Cannabis Cup as a fringe event. 2,500 Americans fly in, do their thing.
Some people say that, and there's a lot more. You can narrow it down to 2,500 Americans, but it's a lot more than that. A way lot more than that. And a lot of people are expatriates, and they're here too. You have Germans, you have all kinds of Dutch people, the Danish people, the English people, the Scots, the Brits, and the Irish as well. Okay. I mean, after all, laddie, we're having a good time here.
Okay. And there's plenty of people Lawrence,
here for distribution.
Listen, for someone whose name is Cherniak, you speak a lot. But listen, you've traveled the world since when, photographing the use of marijuana, cannabis?
Well, since sometime in the 60s, the mid-60s.
What turned you on then?
Well, I was just having fun, you know, getting high because a lady friend of mine had turned me on, and I thought to myself, gee, there's hardly anybody knows about this. Here's another opportunity for me to enhance my personality creatively and artistically because I was interested in, I had already started to decide that I would be an artist. And for an artist, you've got to be prepared to have no limitations in exploring the sentiments and the feelings of what it means to be a real human being on so many levels because there's a long way. Just like, for example, it's impossible for an alien to come to this planet and do the things that some people are so paranoid about. In other words, absorb in 5 minutes every possible thing that is a part of our intelligence. I would like to see any alien, Luke, come here from anywhere in any universe and in 5 minutes absorb everything that's ever been conceived of between the gates of hell to heaven in the minds of a man and a woman. Okay?
Well, there
any alien can do that in 5 minutes, and the rest of what's going on in this planet, good luck to them. Never happened. This is a very sophisticated place. People don't appreciate what an incredible life we have happening here. I'm sure you know that, and anyone else does who's into the wisdom of the great nothingness. This is a miracle that's going on right here, right now, and thank you for sharing it with all these people, Luke. Next question, please. Sir,
well, the question
please,
is, you were
please,
talking
sir.
About the...
But you the must pay some rupees now.
Well, the question is that a man like Terence McKenna, who wrote extensively about magic mushrooms and stuff, said that they were planted here. Alain, one of his suggestions was they were planted here by extraterrestrials to teach us.
I don't have any doubt about that. There's no reason why I should doubt that. I mean, I'm not here to judge things. That's one of the things that we also were nearly touched on a moment ago, this international thing that's going on here in Holland. We're talking about these people who are using these substances, find a way to communicate with each other through these feelings that they have, these sensations, these awarenesses. There's a lot of ways of people communicating. There's certainly one very simple way that everybody in the world speaks the same language. You know what that language is. The one language that everyone understands.
Sex.
Music, Luke. Music.
Oh, music. Oh, excuse me.
Music. But from music can come anything else, okay?
Yeah, yeah.
That's the main reason I'm here. I mean, you heard me playing music here a little while ago, right? Right?
Yeah, you were doing.
I mean, I get to play music here every day. I play music pretty much every day of my life. If
I want to come
music,
back.
I'm not interested in a lot of wherever I am. I have to move on because It's this this.
You're a fast talker. You should have been a salesman.
No, you wanted to have a. You wanted to spend some time. You said, "Can we do this in 15 minutes?" And you saw the way I laughed at you.
Yeah. So now you listen. You were talking about tolerance, and this cannabis and other drugs do induce some tolerance if you use them wisely. Why is there so much controversy, so much opposition against that? I mean, it seems like tolerance on one hand and intolerance on the other hand, like with the politicians.
There's a zillion people out there who can answer all those questions for you and get into all the politics. I'm not the least bit interested in getting into any of the politics as a thing, nor in an interview. If you're interested in discussing with me how these substances were able to open my eyes and make me a better artist because of that was my wish to use these substances to be more creative, then I'm happy to talk to you about that.
Yeah,
but as
that's
for these other things, that doesn't interest me. I don't participate in those things.
What I find amazing is that we have to assume that both Gore and Bush and other people have smoked at least something or had some experience.
I have no doubt that those things may have happened. But it
why does, did they lose the touch?
I'm not interested in... Why did they lose what?
Touch of
because they're faced with economic responsibilities or whatever they are. You see, I mean, look how it becomes difficult for me to even find a word for you because I'm really not interested in talking about it, Luke. I'm much more interested in having an influence with the kind of material that I'm producing that is so above their heads that they can't stop, that ultimately I'm having an influence that way if I'm going to bother with any of this at all. That's why you're here, because some of this means something to you.
Yeah, but you're interested, it has to have a direction, doesn't it?
You're interested in seeing a direction. You're interested in seeing it have an evolution. The only way that that's going to be accomplished successfully is something that you did talk about and mention earlier, either when we were already in this interview or not, I'm not sure, was the medical marijuana thing, or maybe it was when we were talking about our common friend Tim. In any event, that is... the only way is that there's going to be a beginning to a great start. I mean, some amazing things going on because of my position in this incredible world. I get to see some amazing things and hear a wonderful story. Shall I tell you one?
Tell me some stories.
All right, so here's one medical story about a guy who I met several weeks ago, and he had gotten a certificate for the use of medical marijuana in Canada. He's one of 52 people. And I met him at an event that he was going to be speaking at, and so was I, speaking and performing. And he was telling me about how he had been in an accident and how he had physical pain, and he didn't care what it was, whether it was marijuana or not.
Yeah, we praten met Lawrence Czerniak, and hij heeft allerlei boeken geschreven en vooral gefotografeerd over de hele wereld over marihuana en hashish en hoe het allemaal maar heet in allerlei landen. Ganja in India. En het aardige is natuurlijk dat het gebruik daarvan langzamerhand in het Westen niet alleen als hennep, maar vooral ook als medische toepassing steeds toeneemt. Hij heeft wat hij high society noemt, dat is een beetje een woordspeling op zeg maar de high society, maar de mensen die high zijn, daar heeft hij dat boek over geschreven. We gaan dus even met hem praten over waar hij in de wereld allemaal geweest is. Hi Lawrence.
Hey, Lake.
Yes. After the intermission.
After so many years, you know, we keep on passing, our paths keep crossing. And now here we are, having some fun.
Okay. Listen, tell me, you traveled not only America and Europe, but you traveled strange countries.
A lot of strange countries. I mean, it's very interesting. Like what we were mentioning earlier, as a part of my developing my own personality as an actor, I had to be able to reflect so many aspects of the human personality. And that's why I did a lot of all of this in the first place, so that things could be reflected in my artwork. Have you seen any of my paintings?
No, I've seen your books here.
But you haven't seen any of my paintings.
You have?
Yeah, I have a few here I can show you. This is from a line of my postcards in Costa Rica.
Wow.
This is a painting, yeah.
This is a painting. Are we talking real?
Yeah, by hand, right? Here, this.
Not by computer these days.
No. Come on, can't you tell a difference between something that's done by hand or not? There, that's a painting. Here it is here in this book again. There. That's part of my experiences because...
Have you been undersea and have seen this?
I am an assistant scuba instructor. In other words, I'm a rescue diver and a dive master.
And you've been there?
And I've been here, yeah. I have thousands of hours of video. Thousands of photos, yeah, as well.
Now, talking about strange countries, I mean, what is the strangest country you went to and where you found that they were smoking marijuana or something similar?
Oh, I would probably say it's in terms of being strange, that it was unusual. I don't think I ever was anywhere that it was strange.
Unusual?
Well, not even unusual. I was expecting it to find it there, so it wasn't unusual.
But give me some countries.
But there were things that were wonderful to see and, you know, other ways of doing things. And, of course, that includes the first four countries that I really studied at any length, and that was Morocco, Lebanon, Afghanistan, and Nepal, with India and Pakistan in there as well, but primarily those four countries. And understanding the cultures, what motivated the people, so that if I was interested, I could interpret any of these parts of their personalities into the roles or pieces of artwork that I would create or perform. So that I would understand. You know, that's what we're all here to do. We're all absorbing information at this tremendous rate now. There's so much accessible to us. We live in such an incredible world. We were talking about that in the first part of the interview. Anyway, please go ahead.
Now, in that world of, say, in Nepal, and if you compare Nepal with Morocco, would you say that the use of narcotic drugs, psychedelics, had an influence on the spiritual level of the people?
Absolutely. Anybody who gets into these things is a spiritual individual. You and I are spiritual individuals. Whether or not we even get into it, if you're around it, you can't help but sense, well, what binds these people together? What brings them together? Basically, it's as simple as a spiritual feeling, because they don't have to have a prescribed set of rituals. You can make up the rituals as you go along.
What sets them apart from the people who work in the defense industry in the States, for instance? Is that tolerance?
You must think I am some fucking genius if I'm going to tell you the difference between people who are hip and the people who are in the Defense Department of the United States government. That's pretty amazing, Luke. I mean, there's such a diversity in those two aspects as tangents coming to Earth. I mean, they are so far apart. I mean, for me to draw the similarities...
Well, put it in a different thing.
Totally so far apart. They're opposite. You know, it's like fire and water. You know, sometimes you can put them together, but for the most part, they're very, very far apart, and they're going to stay very far apart in terms of being elements.
Polarities, you
said. That's certainly a polarity question, and it's going to be very difficult for us to resolve those things without us making it happen in a way, just the way the wisest people in the world have control and power over a real good, obedient animal. That animal does things as a matter of ultimately being so well trained, and that's what's got to happen to the establishment with how they get trained until they can make the bridge and find their way over to this other world, which has a different philosophical approach in every way in terms of being a world where there is no stress or as little stress as possible, and people are really pursuing those thoughts of tenderness and love, which is what brings families together and helps people to ultimately say, I'm going to nurture my child so that my child can have a real opportunity to explore his own personality and develop that personality, whatever it may be, according to the Bill of Human Rights that was signed by so many countries with the in 1948 for the League of Nations.
Lawrence, that all sounds very nice, and tolerance and freedom and all that stuff. The reality of the world, there is still a war on drugs.
Yeah, but I can't sit here and get involved in a conflict with you about it, whether or not it's going to work or not work, or how I see it being, because what I see doesn't matter, Luke.
No, but parents in Holland are still thinking, and, you know, based on the information they get from the government, they still think, oh, God, my kid is smoking joints in his bed.
I can't do anything about that, and neither can you, except I can create this information and present it to them in a way that's easily absorbed so that it's informative, educational, and yet entertaining. Because if you don't have those three parts to any kind of deliverance of the media, then you're going to lose your public. If it's not informative, if it's not educational and entertaining, they're gone. And so if we would like to get some of this across, which has got to do with this spiritual thing, I think you're bouncing around on too many different levels here. And that's okay. I can pull them all back together. But we're really talking about a spiritual thing and what motivates this community, what motivates this society, what motivates this culture. And that's very nebulous in some ways, because these people don't have to have strict reasons for doing what they're doing, because basically they're anxious to get away, and I know that sounds stressful, but they're anxious to get away from being stressed out. That's why most people smoke, to relax, take it easy, and enjoy life. You know, most of them understand it when, you know, people like me have fun with a nice little Dutch saying that I heard, which was, why drink and drive when you can smoke and fly? Have you not heard that? That's a Dutch expression.
That would go well in your book about the high society.
That's in there. It's in there. I used it. That, but I'm thanks to the Dutch for it. I mean, it's just a whole other thing. I mean, I can only show you things that you may have never seen before. Or probably. I know I can show you things you've never seen before in my books. That's what my books do. That's what all of this stuff is. I'm showing the world. I'm unveiling a shroud of darkness that is just totally awesome. Shall we show you being the first people in the media to see something?
Okay.
Here's a new part of the plant that no one's ever seen before, okay? I took these photos 20 years ago. And this is called the Cherniak occurrence. It's a kind of trichome that's never been seen or identified before on marijuana. Robert Connell Clark, who was just walking by here, I showed it to him on his marijuana 20 years ago. And the same with Jim Goodwin from Ed Rosenthal and Mel Frank. I showed it to him on his marijuana too. And can you see those guys respected me all this time and never ripped me off for the thought or the idea of this occurrence? Here, I'll show you a few more photos of it. Okay? And this is purely a resinous...
There must be thousands or tens of thousands of pictures you made.
Oh, yeah. No, millions. There it is again. Look at this thing. What is this thing? This is the first time I've shared this with the media for free.
What do you think it is?
It's not a matter of what I think it is. It doesn't matter. I'll tell you, a Dutchman has given me a real good theory, though. Look at these. This is obviously a part of the same composition elements as the rest of the plant. Here, look at this. It's just totally incredible. Look at this. What is this? You've never seen this before. This is the first time that I've ever shown it to anyone in the media. So thank you for letting me share that. So here's what my Dutch friend... because after this was published, because I hadn't thought about it, because I've been enjoying doing a lot of other things that are creative things, this could be a grain of pollen, or this is a grain of pollen. And conceivably, if that is true, then it would seem that this has the capability, because of its resinous quality, and they're both sticky, that it could stick to this, and because it's so close to the stigma, that it may be planting a grain of pollen on there to start the fertilization process. That seems logical. From what we're looking at. And that's thanks again to a Dutch friend of mine suggesting
actually that. Looking at new ways of the biology of the cannabis.
So, yeah, it's pretty simple. And not like it's some magical thing going to turn people into, you know, angels or devils.
Good. Let me ask you a practical question. You bring these books from the States. Are they forbidden in the States?
No, they're not forbidden anymore.
They're talking about laws to forbid people to write about these things.
No, they're not. I've never heard of any such laws. Nothing like that is happening. And they've even stopped prohibiting you having how-to books there. The Marijuana Grower's Guide is a how-to book, and so are a lot of other books. They're not prohibited at all. And these books have never had anything. This is considered to be made the world's foremost journalism in the world. Photojournalism. This is major stuff. Regardless, like Harvard University backs these books tremendously and says, notwithstanding the point of view from which anyone approaches this subject, these books are a valuable addition to our library on human behavior.
So they certainly look, because you have photographed people and events all over the world, from American policemen proudly posing to people all over the world, and I think the American bookshops has them.
Oh yeah.
And some grower shops have this book of lore.
Eight countries in Europe are distributing them as well. This third book. Here, for example, I'm getting tremendous publicity in these two magazines. These are current issues now. This is Humphlett magazine. This is my photo on the cover. And if people know my material here where it says Lawrence Cherniak's World of Cannabis, they know that's not all going to be covered in one issue. You can be sure of that. Here, let me show you this. So this is the second last copy of Weed World. Here you can see Lawrence Cherniak joins Weed World. And the title of the series will be Global Ganja. These both have now contracted to do about a year series, 2 year series with me.
Of your pictures.
Of photos from the books, right? So if you take a look here in this magazine now, you can see this is a centerfold as well. These are covers and centerfold. Here's an ad, and you see his previous issues here? And you see he's got one or two here that have sold out. Are you busy, Luke? Here's one that's sold out, and I think there's another one sold out. You see none of these are sold out? Now please look at my photo here on the cover. This one here, right? Do you see that? Now here, this one has just come out. And now here is that same page of his. And see that? Sold out. That's what people...
Lawrence Cherniak and definitely a man who is not too shy to talk about himself here at the Cannabis Cup in Amsterdam.
Honestly, though, in Hawaii, we say, hey, brah, we want to hear you talk good stuff about yourself than shit about someone else.
Thank you, Lawrence. Ja, ten tijde van de Cannabis Cup, die week, meestal in november, dat er heel veel Amerikanen naar Amsterdam komen om hier te proeven, te ruiken, te proberen, te praten over cannabis. Ja, dan loop je allerlei mensen tegen het lijf die iets te maken hebben met die hele cannabis, met de marihuana. Lee Bridges, jij bent de Cannabis Poet en achterop je boekje staat de Cannabis Poet met Ben Dronkers, de man van de Seedbanks. Laten we beginnen met, lees eens een gedicht van je voor.
Ja, oké. Okay. In Amsterdam, it's an Amsterdam scene, you know. So I wrote this for, especially for this scene, because people, they come to see, they come to listen, and they come to feel, and they want to know. And when they get here, they see, and they hear, and more often, many conclude they have learned enough in Amsterdam to be quite capable of making their own decisions regarding the use of cannabis. Although, when drifting away, brows bunch with an acute realization of how difficult it would be indeed trying to convince some folk heaven ain't high.
It feels like you are a proponent of the use of cannabis here and there.
Indeed, very much so. Not only here, I wish it were universal. I wish it were universal use.
It's one of the reasons why you live in Amsterdam.
It is, exactly. It is precisely one of the reasons I live here.
Do you feel that being a poet and using those psychedelics or even cannabis have a relationship?
What kind of relationship? In regards,
I don't know, does it open your eyes?
No, not particularly. It gives you, it's kind of like if you've done a good day's work and you come home at night and want to lie down or sit down and watch television and relax. It doesn't help particularly, nor not in the creative process, not for me. It doesn't help and it doesn't hurt. It's just something you do that you enjoy doing. But as far as your work is concerned, it's absolutely non-essential, as it were. Okay?
You would be still a poet without...
Indeed. I certainly would hope so.
You have a whole book of poetry out. Where do you read that in Amsterdam?
I don't do many readings in Amsterdam in the past few years. I have four books out concerned with the cannabis scene, and two of them are published in America. And in all probability, I'll be going to America next year to do a series of poetry readings and to speak about the Hashish Museum and the Cannabis College, which are two, of course, cultural institutions which are concerned very much with the legalization and understanding of the effects of cannabis.
Okay.
Yeah.